name is Russell Lingerfelt. I'm from Fife, Alabama.
My name is Dusty Breeding. I'm 20 years old. I'm from Andrews, Indiana.
I recently graduated with a master's degree in theology from Pepperdine University.
Right now, I go to Heritage Christian University in Florence, Alabama, where I will be a junior in the fall.
Still don't really think that I know that much. Every time you ask a question and you get an answer, three more questions arise.
When we travel over to Nairobi, Kenya, we're working with a ministry called Made in the Streets, where they bring street children off the slums.
A lot of the parents are dying off because of the AIDS virus, so all these children are being orphaned. And so they believe that right now one out of every 20 children are orphans.
I guess I'm a little nervous about the trip.
I'm not really afraid to die because I see it as the next step, just another step in life. Everybody has to go through it. Everybody's going to go through it.
You just gotta go. You can't worry about things like that. I mean, we're gonna be cautious and try to watch out for things.
I want to be a better person.
I hope that this trip will change me in a way that makes me very much more appreciative of what I have and the people and friends that surround me.
While traveling through Africa, Dusty and I saw everything from extreme poverty, like we see on TV, to the clean-cut middle class who are rarely shown. Lots of questions developed. How did these people become so poor? How do they survive? And why isn't a country apparently rich in resources doing something about it? Once we arrived in Kamulu, a small town outside Nairobi, the capital city, we met a young man named Moses who was able to answer all of our questions.
Where we are walking is Made in the Street compound. This is the farm, and this is a ministry that is concerning street kids that are less fortunate in their family background. Most of these kids that are here have been abused by maybe their parents, the community. So what drives them out to the streets is they kind of disagree with their parents. I mean, some are beaten, some are abused, some are not given food because maybe the parent is too poor to provide. So the best option for most of them is to run to the streets. You go to the streets, you don't find everything good there. I mean, there are people there, you're going to meet other kids, big people too. And I think they get a lot of challenges. I mean, if you're small in size, you're going to get beaten up, you're gonna go through some very terrible times before you're accepted into the streets. There are places called bases. I mean, that's like a community or a group of people who have come together and formed a place, a specific place that they call a base. If you come to the base, you're gonna have to acknowledge who is the master of that base. If you come, it's your first time on the base, you have to ask the other boys, hey, I'm new here, who's the main man here? Will I get beaten up? What do I have to do to be here? If you find the master at the base, I mean, the master is gonna accept you or not accept you, depending on his own feelings. If you're going to please him, if you're not gonna please him, he's gonna send you away. Let me talk about the girls in the base. The girls, according to me, girls are people who go through a lot of problems. I mean, problems that chase them away from home is the same as boys, but mostly for the girls is that they don't want to do a lot of chores at home. They don't want to do a lot of, they don't want to get commands, abusiveness, beating from parents. I mean, most of the girls that we have here in the streets is maybe the mother died, then the father got married to another lady, and this lady is mistreating this girl not in the right way. So the best option for this girl is to go out in the streets and be free from all this.
So for girls, if you go to such a base, if you go to a base, first you have to be like a wife to the master. Okay, you sleep with the master, then you can sleep with anybody else there in the base. That is how they do it.
A girl goes out in the streets, the first thing the girl is going to look for is protection or shelter. So the girl goes in crying, obviously, saying that, hey, I'm running away from home. I have no places to go. So the master of the base obviously is going to say, if you're going to stay here, you're going to give me something back.
If you refuse to sleep with maybe the master, they'll rape you, all the guys in the base. And that is one thing they tell you, they rape you. So, okay, like you're young, you're confused. You're like, okay, I'd rather give in to this one person instead of getting raped with all these people. But at the end of the day, they'll still have to go through you, all of them.
Most of them that we have here, almost all of them have been raped. All of them have had sex with more than one boy.
And again, they expose themselves to STDs and other AIDS, yeah, and other infections. And, you know, they don't know how to protect themselves. So they have babies, they get sick, and, you know, there's no access to medication because there's no money. And some of them just want to have babies because babies are like a security to them. You know, when somebody sees you with a baby on your back or on your lap, and you sit and you're begging, they feel compassion for the baby.
So girls at the bases, their job is just to sit there. Maybe there's a structure of a house, maybe keep it clean. Maybe his food is, if there's some food that the boys are going to bring in the evening, I mean, she's going to have to cook it. Maybe to keep the base clean, stuff like that. I mean, wash clothes for the master. And it's only for the master, because if a master accepts a girl in the base, the girl automatically becomes the master's wife. So she's going to be doing everything like a household wife is going to be doing. This girl is going to be taken care of very good by the boys. I mean, no harm is going to ever come to her. No boy is going to come to the base and say, hey, this is our girl. If such a thing comes and happens, I mean, these boys are going to be on the defense side. They're going to fight this at the base, and they're going to protect this girl, because this girl is making the base clean, is doing every kind of thing, cooking food, washing their clothes if they're dirty, something like that.
Because of the harsh conditions living on the streets, children resort to sniffing glue to escape from reality and to dull their hunger pains.
If you give these boys money, I mean, let's say a street boy comes up to you, you give him money or her money. I mean, this boy, the first thing that will click in this boy's mind is glue, or there's a local brew called Changa. The way they get the money to buy this glue, I mean, you have no idea. Maybe somebody has sweated his head off, worked some garbage, swept some dirty place just to get that 10 shilling to buy that glue. So, I mean, you take a glue from a young boy or one of these boys, I mean, literally they'll cry over it. Maybe they can beat you over it. But someone can cry and beat you over a glue, a bottle of glue. Because glue is more, let's say it's more basic to them than any other thing. From where they're coming from, they do not know real love. I mean, if you go here, hey, get out. If you go here, get out. If you go there, get out. So what we call real love to these kids is, it's not there. I mean, if you try to show them, express the real love, I mean, it's strange to them. I mean, hope, most of these kids' hope is lost. I mean, they don't care whether they die. I mean, that you can tell that by the fights that they have. I mean, somebody can just get out a knife and stab you. I mean, they don't care whether they live tomorrow or not.
so much sorrow and pain, but still I will not live in vain. Like good questions never asked, is wisdom wasted on the past? Only by the grace of God go I, go I am blessed, 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 I am blessed.
Good morning. Here we are in Kamulu in Nairobi, Kenya. And this is part of Made in the Streets, and I'm supposed to look at
Russell.
I'm Charles, and this is...
Darlene. Darlene, the camera, look at me.
Okay, we're going to tell something of the story of Made in the Streets. I want to start with what's going on right now. We have some kids that have been through our program that came from the streets 2, 3, 4 years ago, from sleeping on the streets, from that life of the streets. They were pretty settled in it with this... the using of the glue and the stealing and the begging and all that's part of, you know, the struggling to live every day, have something to eat and a place to sleep. And then they came here and they've spent a few years with us, and now all of a sudden they're ready to leave, and we're also ready to add new team members. And so we're saying to some of them, apply and give your best during the trainee period, and let's see if we want to keep you. Two of the young men who have applied are Anthony and Kennedy. And Anthony and Kennedy are both, I mean, they understand the streets. And so we're looking at them as being a presence on the streets for us in the near future. So if they will go back into the streets, but now they go not as street kids, but as people who are serving street kids.
I had a problem with living with my mom, so, and she was not financially stable. So it's like, she got sick, then she died in 1986. So we went to the up country for the burial. Then after the burial, I came back, and my stepfather told me that he will help me on study, but he was just lying to me. So he just threw me out after coming back to him. So I have tough life after I was thrown out because I had nobody to care for me. So I decided to go to the street. There's a guy that taught me to use the drugs. So I was sniffing glue, taking back, and just injecting myself with the drugs. And I was taking the brown sugar. So it was very hard for me because all those drugs was in my blood. So every time I was just like, oh. So I had tough life. So there's a time that came, I met one of the Made in the Street staff that told me that there's a safe place if I can go there and change my life. I said, yes, I've been suffering a lot in the street and there were no somebody to care for me there. So I decided to change my life, and he told me that you just come on this day, throw everything away, because I'm becoming a good leader and people are getting to like me. On the first issue when I was in the street, no one wanted to see me, no one wanted to hear anything about me. I was just a dirty boy. If I come close to you, I would like go, you stinking. But God is great, as I can say.
Kennedy's one of those kids that didn't have a good family life as a kid. In fact, nobody wanted him in the family.
Well, even when we were all living in Eastleigh, I can remember times when we'd have the kids talk about their home life or what it was like on the streets. Because the reason we're called Made in the Streets is that it's like a Dennis Jernigan song that says, we are shaped by our past, but we are not bound by it. But I can remember, you know, all the other guys were talking about either the streets or their home life, and I can remember Kennedy getting up and leaving with tears.
His family called him Cockroach, part of the time. And once when he went to one of the family's house at a time, I think when he went to see him and found out that his father had died. And then so he asked if he could stay there until the funeral
arrangements.
And they said, no, we don't want bugs on our chairs. And so they wouldn't even let him be around the family. So it's a really difficult thing for him to even think about family or think about someone who would love him the way a real family loves. And I think there was a great barrier he had to break through to recognize that God would be father for him and that this father would be someone who cares because Kennedy's father didn't care either.
You know, when you read the life stories of somebody, then it just makes you, sometimes it makes you angry, makes you cry, makes you just feel for somebody. And then you see what they can become when they're out here with God's love and when God changes somebody's heart and mind and their life. And that's why we're here.
The Made in the Streets Ministry developed and built a strip mall featuring a variety of businesses operated by the students within the program. This provides training in a real-life enterprise so that when they graduate from the program, they are ready to use their skills in the workforce.
Otter Creek, our sponsoring congregation, said, but you know what? You've got kids off the streets, they've gone through literacy, and they're learning a job skill. But what you really need to pair with the job skill classes is businesses that they can learn in and then work in. And so now we have our very own little strip mall with a salon and a tea house, and then the tailoring and woodworking will be selling your stuff there.
Well, we have a woodworking program. We have a friend from California who came over and trained some of our team members in carpentry and bought equipment for us and set us up. So we've got power equipment, so they can make cabinets, they can make craft items for sale, they can make beds, they can make wardrobes, they can make shelves, a lot of different kinds of things. And we have them making things for Made in the Streets as well as making things to sell. This is interesting. The guys from the woodworking program, the two team members and the four boys that they had working with them in the program, actually build our basketball court. We build a regulation college size court, concrete. And we had some men from the community that did the mixing, and then our young men did the finishing work. We've got a hairdressing program. We have our own salon, and we've sent a lot of kids out. Seems like a lot of girls want to do hairdressing. We have a computer shop so that kids can learn computers. And our idea there is that every kid studies computers so they can build confidence and learn English. It helps with that, and just all kinds of good things. And Maiden Street started, the whole thing started with a desire to have kids have a chance at something different for their lives than it looked like they were going to have. And it's not that we planned it, it's not that we set out in the beginning and said, let's have a street ministry, you know, let's be street ministers. It's that we met street kids going about our business of life. We met them, and they got in our hearts, and we got closer and closer to them. Some street kids became teachers in the church. They became important people to us. And then we faced the question of going back to the U.S. from here, but we had met street kids. And so we decided we can't go and stay in the U.S. because there are some kids here whom God is calling. And so Made in the Streets was born out of a program one day. One Thursday, we spent all day with a group of 200 street kids. And out of that came the necessity in our lives of doing something for kids. And so Made in the Streets has just grown from there, from just a Sunday morning program where 55 to 60 kids came in every Sunday, to serving hundreds of kids out on the streets. And then having a boarding program now where we have 32 kids currently going through, living with us and, you know, sharing this life.
Hallelujah.
The farm provides dormitories for both the boys and the girls. With the graduation of Anthony and Kennedy, two more spaces were available in the program. This means that two more children in dire jeopardy would be given the opportunity for a hopeful future. But if those on the farm ever run back to the streets, they're not allowed to return to the program. This policy maintains discipline and protection for the other students. During our time with Made in the Streets, we were able to capture on film the process of how the children are selected.
We need to know their name. We also need to know their age and the year they were born and now the family history. Their background, where they come from and what led to their ending up in the streets. Ask these kids and to know if they really want to change their lives by coming into our program, and if they really want to change their lives, what are some of the things they think of? And when the kids tell us that they want to learn and to change their old life from the streets and to become better people in the society, then we know they have passed their interview.
Before we bring the boys in, we have to make sure that they are ready to change. And so when we tell them that we are going to take them into our program, then we have to sit them down and tell them the things that they must be ready to stop. They must be ready to stop taking blue, they must be ready to stop the life of living on the streets, they must be ready to stop stealing and all the lying. And then from there we tell them we can bring you in, but no, when we take you in, you are going to follow a few rules and a few things that other people who come into the program do. So we prepare them for the new changes that they are going to go through before we take them to the clinic and then again out to the farm.
These two boys were re-interviewed last week, and according to their family history and the interview, they gave all the information that we require. And so today what we are going to do is to take them to their relatives so that we may get their documents, and from there we take them to the clinic to be tested, and then they will be ready to get into our boarding program.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They learn much more than I'll ever know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Dusty and I had come to Africa to change street kids, but discovered that the greatest change came in us. As time passes, the students will mature and eventually leave the farm, but their memory will remain with us, and I'm sure that we will remain with them. And though we will eventually be forgotten, the 4 weeks that we spent with them planted seeds, and those seeds will live on. Here in Kenya and around the world, there are children starving in one way or another. We discovered that no matter our age, gender, or past, anyone can help these kids. All that is needed is a willingness to serve. All the kids need is your willingness to love.
Okay, I would just like to say thanks for, when we first got here, you did not treat us as mentors or teachers or visitors. You treated us like family. And when we go back home, we know that you will be a part of our family.
I just want to tell all you guys that I'm really inspired by you. Some of you older guys like Joel and Robin and Abraham and just all of you, Moses, Benjamin, I'm really inspired by how you handle different situations with the young guys, and I'm really proud of you. So just thank you all for everything and for just for the past month that we spent together. I've really had a blast.
If you ever feel tempted to go back to the streets, remember that you have a family here who loves you. And God loves you. Don't miss that. That is all.
So.
Nakupenda. He loves you all.
You never try, you'll never know just what you were. Lights will guide you home and ignite you. Thank you.
say bye in 5 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.